torn down. But thanks to fundraising, it was saved by a group of community volunteers, folks like you. And now, the West Dales is showpiece, a not-for-profit charitable organization restored to its full glory and heritage designated to boot. Cool. So then right from this very seat, you could check out way more than just great movies. There's all kinds of arts and culture, music, talks, performances, and of course, popcorn. But like in all good stories, there's an unexpected twist. 2020 hits and bam, the new normal, with stages going dark all over the world. Thank you. Now, it doesn't take a PhD in accounting to know, no lights, no camera, no cash. Which means we need a little help from our friends to keep on keeping on. So if you can donate a little or a lot, it sure would help us keep the lights on, making you one of the heroes of this story. Stay tuned for the next chapter in the West Dale.
Hey, hello, folks, and welcome to Hamilton Originals here from the West Dale Theater. Tonight, our special guest, Rik Emmett. Hi, Rik.
Hey, man.
Okay, Rik Emmett is here. We're going to start out with a couple of songs.
All right, here we go. This one's called The King of Rock and Roll.
When life lays out ahead of us and reach exceeds our grasp, everything seems possible, sweet dreams built to last. Youth runs quick and hungry, fairy tales get swallowed whole. Long live the king of rock and roll. And as the game progresses, the playbook raises doubts. High priests in cathedrals bury secrets in their house. By the tricks they're turning, an illusion of control. Long live the king of rock and roll. Oh, time keeps running, never rests in peace. Nothing stops the revolutions. It's the signature of the beast. 2 minutes to midnight on the doomsday clock, promises betrayed in this place that hope forgot. We build things up, we tear them down, we crush them heart and soul, till there's nothing left for the king of rock and roll. Oh, and now the land grows dark and empty, and the wind wicked cold, threw a crown of thorns on the king of rock and roll. The king is dead. Long live the king, the king of rock and roll.
Rik Emmett, folks. Yeah, right here in the hood.
Thank
oh,
you.
Thanks, Rik.
Welcome.
I think you're going to switch to your other guitar.
I am, sir.
And I think that gives me a perfect opportunity to tell the folks how we met. It was through my ex-wife's family. God bless them all. And especially Lee Olson, one of your old-time buddies, I think, from the past.
Lee and I go way back. Lee was pals with the guy who was my manager, Ross Monroe. I think they
Ross
played.
Ross Monroe.
Yeah, they played in a band together in high school or
That's
something.
Right. He had the Rickenbacker bass, I think.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Sure.
And we got a shout out to his son, Ryan, in Chicago. I think we got a few people from down in the U.S. of A. watching this, but my favorite nephew, Ryan Olson, down there in Chicago. So.
This guitar came from Lee. I switched when the Fender came out with this model. I liked it. You couldn't get it in Canada. And so I had a guitar, and I knew that Lee always sort of lusts after guitars in my collection. I said, I'll switch you out the White Whale. There was a Yamaha White Whale. I said, I'll... And so I got this one. And yeah, I call this one Annabella, which is a white lady, a ghost. So yeah, nice. And I'm going to play a tune for you now. Do we do that or do we talk some more?
I'm just going to sit back and watch.
Okay. This is called High Five. And generally speaking, because the first song was kind of dark, I figured I'd do one that's kind of up and happy. But it'll be a challenge because I haven't played this one live very often. And it's the beginning of the night, so I'm not sure if I'm warmed up enough for this. Yes, exactly. I need a little roaring fire. And anyways, this is called High Five.
High Five.
Yeah, here we go.
Nice. High five. Thank you. That was great.
You're welcome.
Well, we better get into a bit of the Triumph thing. I we got to talk a little bit about those guys. We're going to start way back then. I know they, when did that start? 75?
For me, September of 75. Mike Levine, the bass player, and Gil Moore, the drummer, they had the plan for it, and they were searching around trying to find guitar players. I think they even auditioned a guy named Jerry Doucette. You remember Jerry Doucette?
From Hamilton.
The Deuce is Loose. Yeah. But when they saw me playing at the Hollywood Tavern in Toronto, they went, oh, that's our guy.
Oh, yeah.
Levine said he's a little short.
Well, but they had those platform shoes there. You could have worn.
Yeah, and I had those in the early days. Yeah. So anyhow, September of 75, our first gig was at Simcoe County High School.
Okay, Simcoe, that tobacco country.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. So that was where it all began. And,
And what was, did you guys have some hits at that point, or you were still recording?
Oh, geez, we didn't even have an album yet.
Right,
they had a single. Levine was pretty smart, and he had a friend, Tom Williams, at Attic Records. So they literally had a record deal before they even had a band. And the deal was, let's cut a little single. We'll put it out. The band can start playing some shows. The single will, try and promote it at radio. We had the number one song in Dryden, Ontario.
Dryden?
When we went to play there, yeah.
Hey.
Because they, for some reason, the radio station there had played the record. So, but when Attic, we came to Toronto and we played at the Nob Hill Tavern, and they came out to see us, and they went, okay, we want an album. As soon as you can make it, we want it.
Nice.
So that was, we were now sort of into the beginning of 76, maybe even middle of 76. And so we made the first album, and it was simply called Triumph. Yeah.
Yeah. Nice. And there you are.
Look at that.
Nice pants.
Yeah. That's a little later on. That would have been 80. Yeah. 81, somewhere around there, those outfits.
I just had to show the pants, though.
Yeah, I had three or four pairs of those. I had a red pair, blue, and I had an orange pair.
Ooh.
Yeah, and the orange were really good with the black T-shirt, orange and black. And Hamilton would like that. Those are tabby colors, right?
Oh, yeah. You see?
Tabby orange and colors. Black. Yeah. So.
Yeah, yeah. And what was your first hit?
The first big one we had in Canada was Rocky Mountain Way, and that was a cover song of the Joe Walsh tune.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that was like that was making our second album, Rock and Roll Machine, and we were desperate for it. We were always desperate for material. Never had enough stuff. We'd be in pre-production and be going, well, what else can we do?
Yeah.
Which was why I ended up getting to put guitar pieces and even, you know, weird jazz songs on records, because we just didn't have enough rock material.
Yeah, oh yeah.
So, you know, we hadn't written enough stuff. Anyway, so Rocky Mountain Way was one of the tunes we used to do in the early days when we were a bar band playing cover tunes. And Gil could sing it great, so it was like, okay, let's do it. So that we were literally able to tour and start to play arenas in Canada based on the success of that record at radio across Canada. So that was the first one.
Yeah. And then the big break, though, I guess in the U.S. came with Hold On, was it?
It was more Hold On, Lay It on the Line. It was the whole Just a Game album project was one where they really decided they were going to go for it. So we had all the bells and whistles, like they had Just a Game dice, and they had, you know, cardboard cutout thingies hanging in record stores. And the smartest thing, this was the genius. Levine got money out of them so that we went up to Kleinberg and we went onto a soundstage and we shot, you know, just syncing to the actual, but we did like four songs, Hold On, Lay On the Line, Moving On, and American Girls. So four songs from, and RCA at the time, they had these new VCR machines and they were desperate. They were in a heavy competition against Sony Betamax machines.
Oh, the Beta VHS.
Right. So RCA said, we're going to put a VCR machine in every single record store in America, and we're going to put a Triumph cassette in there that's going to be on a loop, and it's going to play those videos. And we went, okay, great.
Okay.
You know, so that was the first thing that was great about it. The second thing that was genius about it, and this was just serendipity, MTV started, and they desperately needed videos of bands, and, well, we just happened to have
just
four.
Happened. Yeah.
Yeah. Here so. And there was one moment in particular, which I think of this as serendipity. When we were doing Lay It on the Line, there was a camera that had a kind of a close-up of my face when I was singing the end of the intro. I don't ask for much. The truth will do just fine, won't you? Lay it on the line. And there's this flap, boop, 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 like drum fill, followed by flash pot directly behind my head. By the back line, but from the camera, it was just like it whited out the screen, and then my face came out of the sparkles and the. So it was like, oh, a money shot.
Yeah.
Like nobody planned it.
No.
But it was like the best money. So when MTV would clip their, MTV bumpers together and use a little bit of this guy, a little bit of this girl, a little bit of this band, they would always use that shot of Rik Emmett emerging from the flash pot flames. So it was like,
Man. Yeah. Serendipity, eh?
Yeah.
Now, what about the San Antonio connection? I read about that.
Yeah.
That was kind of a launch pad of sorts.
I mean, well, first of all, I can't mention these things without mentioning the fact that Rush had lovely coattails that we could ride. You know, Rush would break markets at radio, and they were this Canadian trio from Toronto. And so here comes along Triumph, and, we're you know, kind of everybody's going, another one. And the singer sings hi, and oh, wow, fancy guitar player. Oh, okay, great. So, you know, the door was already open, and all we had to do was just sort of stick our foot through it. In San Antonio in particular, there was two guys, Lou Roney and Joe Anthony. They were, and this was the old school kind of disc jockeys could call their own shots and do their own thing. And Joe Anthony used to do the midnight show, and all the Tex-Mex people would listen to him because he was a kind of a Tex-Mex kind of guy. And he loved Blinding Light Show, and he played that song like it was Stairway to Heaven. So every night at midnight, Blinding Light Show got played in San Antonio. And so Triumph became kind of like, oh, this, there's such a cool band, such a great band. Oh, we got. So then we were going to do a show. There was going to be a show at Municipal Auditorium. And that guy in the picture, Sammy Hagar, he was going to headline the show. And then he got a chance to, I can't remember what, like, you know, headline Madison Square Garden or something. He pulled out of the San Antonio show. And
that's when.
Yeah. And Joe Anthony calls us up and says, hey, will you guys come in and headline instead of Sammy on this thing with the Runaways and Yesterday and Today, I think was the other band. And so we had to headline. So we had to fly down there with all of our flash pots and flamethrowers. And
but like, I heard when you got the call, you thought for a split second, you thought, geez, I don't know if we're ready for that.
Oh, but that, we, no. We weren't. But
then you thought, oh, let's go. We got to do it.
Triumph was always, it was a thing about sort of like a helium balloon, you know. We were always going to like, if we weren't ready, we were going to pump it so full of hot air that it was going to float. It was going to fly anyhow. You know, we were going to figure out a way.
Well, so, speaking of Blinding Light Show, I think we got a clip of that. Do we, Mark?
Oh, boy. Look out.
Let's see this.
Is it going to run?
Blinding Light.
Now, we played, that song was a song that I wrote with Denton Young and Chris Brockway in the band that I was in before Triumph, Act Three. Yeah. And yeah. I think Chris Brockway was really the guy that had the original idea of writing a lyric that was about, you know, rock shows or blinding light shows, but that's they're misleading. It's you know, it's a horrible, terrible thing. So there's something quite ironic about the fact that, you know, Triumph became known as, Denton went on to have a band called Zaun, and it was pretty successful kind of a band.
Oh, yeah.
But he was like a drummer, and then he came out and be a front man. Anyways, those were the writers. Yeah.
Well, enough about Triumph. Let's move on to the.
Hey.
The newer era.
Okay.
Because I know, I guess you left them in, when was that,
88. Yeah.
And started doing your own thing, right? Right then and there.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it took a little bit. I did some co-writing with some outside writers. Epic Records had given me some money to do some demos, and then they didn't want they passed. And so then I made a production deal with Phase One Studios, and I made a whole album, and then we shot the album. And in the end, it was only Duke Street Records in Canada that took it, but in the States, Charisma Records took it. So then I was kind of back on the rails again and rolling with the Absolutely album. And I did a sneak preview tour before the album came out with Kim Mitchell. And I had a big band. I had... Colleen Allen was playing saxes, and so I had a female sax player. I had keys, another guitar. It was a cast of thousands.
And there was a lot of different styles that came out of that era, no?
Like yes.
Jazz and...
Well, not so much that. Like, what I was doing, I mean, first of all, the record company was saying, you're going to rock, right? You're not going to go all progressive crazy on us. Yeah. And so, I mean, the cover, I had a Les Paul in a black leather jacket. It was like, hi, rock star, you know, I'm here. So, and there was rock on it, but there was, I was trying to say, I'm a singer-songwriter, you know, I wanted that stuff to start to come out. And there were a few progressive things. Even though that was dying. I mean, very quickly what was happening in the radio marketplace was the whole advent of like Nirvana, Soundgarden, you know, Stone Temple Pilots, all that stuff was coming. And so, you know, guys that were in hair bands from MTV, like that was like, nobody wanted that anymore.
Done.
You know, so, and of course, if you're pushing 40, I might have been 41. I can't remember how old I would have been. But, you know, it's like, yeah, but once we got into the 90s, it was like you could tell that it was sort of over. And if I didn't start changing who I was and what I did, you know,
it
was going to be over. Yeah. So I was like, okay, how can I convert this into something that will, you know, at least make me happy?
Yeah, that's a good start.
Yeah, so it was like, okay, so now there was more fingerstyle, jazz, classical guitar pieces. You know, the songs became sort of more like ballads, and there was no rock at all. There was really just, you know, I'd have a reggae tune or something. You know, it was, I was being self-indulgent, but having a lot more fun.
Well, and that's so important, isn't it, as a musician? Because you can often get pigeonholed, and you got to do the same thing every night, and
it
can get really boring, I know.
Yeah, I mean, the other thing, too, of course, is that, you know, I mean, I was talking to a guy today, and we were talking about music, and how there's relative things that occur in the theory of music, in the making of music. And then songs can relate to each other. There's relational things between our brains and our brain chemistry and music. There's, you know, relational things that occur. And it's all one big thing, really. It's only the marketplace that decides, and this bin is for jazz, and this bin over here is, you know, like the labels come on through the course of the commercialization and the marketing of it. In a musician's head, it can often be easy to slide from one style to another, from one musical idea to another, you know. So I wanted to make my life be a little bit more about that and a little bit less about, well, are we getting enough airplay in Peoria? I don't care, you know.
Well, and I think you've always done that, followed your heart and, you know, I mean, obviously the money's good there in the beginning, but I think after a while you probably thought, I got to get into the art side of it more than the money side and do what I think is best for me, what I feel myself doing.
I think that's true. And of course, you know, let's not make this sound like I'm so high-minded. Like, really what's happening is also, you know, the bathwater of the, you know, the early parts of a career, it's running, it's going. That's down the drain. Bye-bye. You can't be 25 years old and be all about testosterone. I mean, come on, that guitar lick and Blinding Light show. Like, it's a little self-indulgent that, you know, like, you're not going to be doing that all your life, are you? Like, so, you know, that stuff didn't really carry into the 40s and the 50s of my life. You know, there were other things that were going to be more appropriate, age appropriate. You know, so, and the other thing was that I think I always wanted to be in music because I wanted to play. Not because I wanted sex and drugs and rock and roll. Not because I wanted to be famous, you know. I mean, it was nice that these things had happened, but really, I wanted to play, and I wanted to play stuff that, you know, I would enjoy playing, you know. So as the large pressures of the business went away, then it was like, okay, so how can I make it be, well, play smaller places, you know, have less ambition, don't have to take out a big band, go out solo or duo or, you know, whatever, little trio. Like, you know, how can we make it work? And I was able to make it work for a lot of decades. It was good.
Yeah, and I'm sure in a way it was almost as much or more fun because of the variety of things you could do, the different players you could play with. You know, it's a whole different scene, I'm sure, than when you're just in that one early band.
Absolutely. You know, they showed a picture earlier there of me on stage with Sammy Hagar and Ted Nugent. But I've also been on stage with George Benson. And I've also been on stage with Steve Vai. And I've also been on stage with Steve Morse. And you and I were talking earlier, I've played with Ed Bickert, which was one of the biggest thrills of all.
Ed Bickert. You may not know that guy, but a killer, killer guitar player. Hey, we've got some pictures here, speaking of players that you played with.
Oh, okay.
I just grabbed a few off the internet.
Oh, boy.
Now, this is going way back.
I thought, who's that young fellow? That's Bruce Coburn, by golly.
I thought, is that Bruce Coburn?
Yeah, Bruce and I did a TV show in Hamilton, CHCH, and 81, I think it might have been, 81 or 82.
Oh, yeah.
And I played, it was his band. We just picked them up as the house band, and they played some Triumph songs, like he played Fight the Good Fight with me, and it was great. It was Never Surrender, and then I played a bunch of his tunes, and we played a Django Reinhardt piece.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, we had some fun.
He's a great guitarist
and a great
songwriter.
That right hand of his, right there on his hip, that's an unbelievable machine, that thing.
Yeah. Bruce, one of my faves. Yeah. Next, we've got Dominic Triano and Jeff Healy. There's a couple of monster players.
Yes, that was the White Ribbon Benefit, and that was the last year of Dominic's life. And Jeff, he passed away maybe 3 or 4 years later. Mm. But, we played, I think we played Watchtower, and I can't remember what else. It was a couple of things we did. But the best thing of all was when we went out for dinner. Because the guys in the band, Jeff didn't come with us, but Donnie and I got to sit together, and it was just really, really sweet. It was a bunch of musicians sitting around having some Thai food.
Thai food?
Thai food, and just guys telling stories about sessions they'd done with Donnie, and when he was doing the music for, what's it called, Night Shift CTV. Like, he did a lot of TV stuff, and a lot of these guys had played with him, and Donnie was just one of the elite Canadian guitar players, from the original era, like the Mandala.
Yeah,
and then he ended up in the Guess Who. He played in James Gang for a while. Like, Donnie got around. But my favorite Donnie story, I'll tell it real quick. I'm going to end up telling too many stories, and this show will run long.
That's all right.
Okay, the Donnie story is I go to the Imperial Room at the Royal York Hotel to see Joe Pass.
Joe Pass.
And Joe Pass is one of the greatest jazz guitar players on the planet Earth, and I'm sitting about 3 or 4 tables back. And at one of the first tables right near the front, Dominic Triano is sitting, right, and watching the thing. And Joe finishes his little set, and he's, gonna take a little break now, puts his guitar down, lights a big cigar, steps off the stage and goes up to Donnie and goes, "Hey, mio man, mio pazzi, hold it." And they're like, I can't speak Italian, sorry. But it's like, hey, vietato fumare questo edificio. And they're like hugging, and they sit down together. I'm thinking, wow, Joe Pass knows Dominic Troiano. Like, wow.
Yeah.
So it was really
That's cool.
Yeah.
Yeah, the Mandala. Yeah, Prakash John was in that, wasn't he?
He was. He was. Yeah,
he's still playing around with his son.
Yep.
Next, we have another great jazz player.
Not just jazz. Tommy Emmanuel could play anything, and it would sound unbelievable. He's my favorite guitar player, I think, on the planet Earth.
Oh, yeah?
Well, my favorite. I would have to say my favorite to have to listen and sit and enjoy. I would pick Pat Metheny maybe as the greatest living guitarist. That's my favorite living.
My wife's favorite too, I know.
Yeah, I think he's sort of more of a wide-ranging artist than Tommy, but Tommy technically can play just about anything. And I'll tell you this, if Tommy had decided he wanted to be a drummer, he would have been the greatest drummer in the world. If he decided he wanted to be a sax player, he would have been the greatest sax. He's one of those kind of guys. He's like a Paul McCartney kind of character, but he doesn't sing as good as McCartney.
Yeah.
But he's got that, that genetic gift where it's just he lives and breathes music. You want to hear a great Tommy story?
Sure.
He's flying around, and this might have been even in Canada, I'm not sure, but he's in one of those sort of secondary kind of airports, like, Timmins or someplace, and they've landed, and the baggage, they're having a hard time getting it off the plane. So everybody from the plane is just waiting around in this baggage area for the bags. Tommy always carries a guitar on. So Tommy in the baggage area goes, you folks want to hear his tone? I go, yeah. He goes, all right. He stands up on the seats, and he starts playing. Like he starts doing a concert for the people that are waiting for their
luggage.
That's Tommy. Like he's just irrepressible.
Oh, great. Okay, next we've got Alex, I think. Okay.
Yeah, that's me and Alex.
Like, what's going on here? What are
this
all those?
This is the Canadian Guitar Workshop, run by my good friend Brian Murray, and that would have been in Oakville at the Appleby College, in the auditorium there, and yeah, I think we were about to play a version of Working Man, the Rush song Working Man, and all of the kids were going to play the lick, the down 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 whatever. I don't remember how the lick goes, but.
Yeah.
Somebody ran up behind us on stage and said, "Hey, turn around. I got to get a picture with everybody in the crowd." Oh, all the guitars.
It's a great shot.
Alex is, people have no idea what an artist he is.
Yeah.
Alex Lifeson is like a Renaissance man. He can paint like Monet. Huh. And I'm not joking. I've seen, like, we've done paintings for charity things, and mine are, you know, okay. And his are like, oh, my God, why am I even bothering when his is so good? And he's a sommelier. He understands wine from the ground up all the way, like flies planes. Oh. He plays guitar, but he could do anything.
He does it all.
And he's a good golfer, too. Yeah. I don't know if he's a scratch golfer, but he's,
great Alex Lifeson.
Yeah.
And lastly, I think we've got the Hawk.
Oh, there's Ronnie.
Ronnie Hawkins. I got to say, he's going to be here. I think it's November 2nd. Actually, he's not going to be here. He's phoning in.
Okay.
He's coming on with my friend Gary Lucas. But, yeah, what's the story with that picture?
Ronnie just calls me Ricky. And, you know, every time I see him, he says, like, come on, you got to come join my band. I've had everybody in my band. I've had Robbie Robertson. I've had Larry Gowan play in my band. Come on, you got to come play my band. And I go, Ronnie.
Hey, son. He probably called you son, too.
Everyone's
son, right?
Everybody's son, yes.
What a character.
And he always the same jokes, you know. But they're always funny.
And a million of them.
Yeah.
But we probably can't repeat here.
No, most of them we can't.
And lastly, I think, yes, I need an explanation of this. Last week on the show, we had Ian Thomas. You can see him in the distance there.
There he is, yeah.
And when I saw this photo, it said you guys were on set. What's that mean?
Okay, so there was this thing that they were shooting that was like an illustrated men. The guy in the hat with the glasses, I'm never going to remember their names now, but there was a comedy trio called the Illustrated Men. And that's my pal Rick Wharton. He's sort of Second City trained kind of guy. But he sort of became like my marketing guy, my you know, secondhand man, kind of would go out on the road with me, would help promote shows and things. And so Wharton knew some guy that was filming some sort of thing where I think Ian and I had to, it was like we were coming out of a bar, and this was like one of those strip joints on Queen Street in the East End. So we were coming out of the you know, smelly, stinky strip bar, and then these guys were going to run into us on the street, and there was going to be some sort of a conversation about, hey, wow, hey, Rik Emmett, hey, Ian Thomas, like as if we were being recognized as celebrity musicians by these comedians. But I think they were playing roles, like, you know, one guy was a down and out comic, one guy was a scuzzy agent, like something, you know, I don't know. But it was like a cameo thing, and it took all of, you know, 20 minutes, a half an hour to shoot it at the corner of whatever that is, Coxwell and Queen or whatever that was.
Now, you've done some recording with Ian, I think.
Ian and I have done a lot of things together. That CHCH show that I mentioned earlier that I did with Bruce, a few years later I did one with Ian.
Well, it's funny you mention that because we happen to have a clip from that, I believe.
Okay.
And you got to see these guys bopping their heads like Wayne and Garth.
Oh, look out.
magic power.
Great. Oh, too bad we didn't have Ian sang You Shook Me by Led Zeppelin during that
show. Oh, yeah. And I watched a fair bit of it. He also did You Really Got Me by the Kinks.
Oh, right. That was
Ian
great.
Ian singing You Really Got Me.
Oh, that was fantastic.
It's hard to pick what clip to show on my little show here.
Yeah.
But I figured
I'm glad you favored
me. You
two
doing the pogo there.
Yeah,
was pretty
good.
Yeah,
that was good. It was me.
I like
how,
that.
How can I get more of me in there? And there is me with my Dave
okay,
Dunlop.
Okay, well, this is the whole Dave Dunlop era, which is still going on,
we don't play gigs anymore. We talk on the phone sometimes now because of COVID and stuff, you know.
But
we might do some writing and recording together again. I don't know. But, yeah, Dave and I, it was almost 2 decades. We did albums together, and it was great. It was a lot of fun. He's more of a rocker than anything else.
Oh yeah.
And so, but it was an acoustic duo, so it was good because it kind of kicked my butt a little bit that it was like, you know, don't get too soft too soon there, Uncle Ricky. You know,
don't
like,
be a folk singer.
Yeah. It was kind of
keep it going.
Yeah, the duo ended up having a little bit more spine than that. It was kind of nice, and there would be Latin things that we do that we jam and
yeah.
There was a lot of butt kicking.
I saw you guys in Chicago a few years ago when Ryan got married. I think it was.
Yeah.
At that club in Chicago, and it was fantastic.
Yeah, those were city wineries. There's a run. There's like 9 of them now, and we were in there. We could play any one of those. They had them in Nashville, New York, Chicago, and we could go and play them and sell them out. It was great.
Yeah,
nice places to play. Very civilized. Nice dressing rooms. Good food. Lovely wine.
You gotta love that.
Yeah. Why would I retire from that? I don't know. Oh, yeah. Airports.
Yeah, right. Airports.
Yeah.
And
Ubers.
Suitcases.
And checking in and out of hotels.
And
having
family.
To talk to agents about why things. Oh, yeah. Now I remember.
How about a couple songs?
Yeah, what do you want to hear?
I'm thinking one you haven't done for a while, Ordinary Man.
Oh, okay. Yes.
Hey?
Right. Yeah, yeah. I'm going to mute this.
I'm just going to sit and listen.
This song was it was on the LA Forces album, and when I originally wrote it was just a folk song, but you know, we'd turned it into a sort of an epic. When I started doing the duo shows with Dave, this became a very popular tune, and it would get requested a lot, and so it became one of the evergreen triumph songs, like Magic Power, Fight the Good Fight, Land on the Line. But Ordinary Man kind of joined the club. And it's because it's autobiographical, and it has a lot of, obviously, if you've got people in the seats that are fans, they love the fact that you're saying, look, I'm just the same as you. I'm just an ordinary man, you know. And the stories that you can tell about being on the road, you're finding out that there's 18,000 people cheering for you, you know, and then you go, you know, to the limo and you're driving back and you're realizing, you know, it's a whole different thing. And people sort of like to be able to get a sense of that, you know. But of course, I think the song has relevance now just because the COVID circumstances and everybody having to be in isolation and sort of face life more from a point of view of, what if there isn't a lot of other stuff going on? What if it's just this?
Yeah.
You know, so that kind of thing. So that's what the tune's about. Look in the mirror, tell me, what do you see? Or can you lie to yourself like you're lying to me? Do you fall asleep real easy, feeling justified and right? Or do you wake up feeling empty in the middle of the night? You wanna think you're different, but you know you never can. You're just another ordinary man.
politician, can't believe a word you say. Oh, mighty media, whose truth you said today. Watchdog of justice, who keeps their eye on you. Con man, song in hand, who you singing to. The more I get to see, the less I understand. I'm just another ordinary man. Ordinary man. Just another ordinary man. Ordinary man. There comes a time to take a stand. Once I thought the truth was gonna set me free. Now I feel the chains of its responsibility. I will not be a puppet, for I cannot play it safe. I'll give myself away with a blind and simple faith. 'Cause I'm just the same as you. I just do the best I can, 'cause that's the only answer for an ordinary man. Ordinary man. Just another yourself. Ordinary, just another ordinary man. Ordinary man. There comes a time to take a stand.
Sorry, there's no thunderous applause. There's only six people out there, but
yeah, that's all right.
Yeah. How about another one? I think it was going to be Midsummer.
Yeah, yeah. Can I stand up for this one?
Please.
Yeah, because I'm used to playing this one standing up.
I'll raise this up for you.
No, I don't need the mic. And this is going to be an instrumental. So I'll yak about it, and then I'll stand up and do it. So, yeah, this was a tune, as I'd said earlier. Triumph was always short of material for albums, and so early on, Mike Levine had said, can you put a guitar piece on there? And I went, sure I can.
Sure I can.
So I would write him and get him in there. So by the time I got to the Thunder 7 album, I was thinking, okay, I know what a live show really needs now for the classical guitar thing. I can't play it yet, but I can write it, and then I can record it the way Glenn Gould would record, like, I'll do pieces
of it.
And I'll edit it together, and then I'll learn it to be able to play it live. So this was one that I learned. Let me just check this and see if I can. That sounds like a concert hall. That'll do. Okay, so this would be, you know, I would walk out under the laser cone and with my classical guitar and do this in the middle of the set when everybody would have been firing up their dubs. to get really, because they go, oh, it's the middle of the show, guitar player's doing his self-indulgent guitar thing. That's great, let's get high. And then, you know, the show is going to just ramp up from here, you know. So I'd walk out there and get to the front of the stage, and of course, secondhand smoke, I'd be playing my licks and going, man, am I hungry.
Yeah, give me some Oreos.
All right. My legs have gone to sleep. My
Rik Emmett, folks, that guy, whoa. My brain doesn't follow those licks that fast enough. That is some wild playing.
Thank you.
Yeah, that's good, Rick. Now, we're getting close to the close of the show, and I just wanted to find out a bit more about what you're doing lately. I noticed this on the internet. You've got folk songs for the Farewell Bonfire. What's
yes.
that all about now?
Well, you know, the first song I did this evening was from that. It was like 18 kind of folk songs. I'd always wanted to do a record. One of the first records that I owned when I was a little kid was the Bob Dylan, the eponymous Bob Dylan record.
The first one.
Yeah, well, yeah, he'd done it with John Hammond had produced it, and it was just Bob and his acoustic guitar singing for a couple of microphones. And so I always liked that record. There was something magic to me about that record. And so I always wanted to do one. So I thought, well, you know, no time like the end of your career. And so I was thinking this might be the last thing I do. So Farewell Bonfire, I thought, and folk songs. Like when I was a teenager, you'd take your acoustic guitar to the, you know, Wasaga Beach or whatever, you'd get it out and everybody'd be sitting around and, you know, having a few beers and telling a few stories. And so that was kind of, that's what I wanted to do. I wrote a bunch of songs and I did that. And of course, I couldn't stop. Me being me, I ended up doing six jazz guitar pieces. A couple of the songs, they were going to sit better on an electric guitar anyways. So I did them on this telly because they had jazz changes and stuff, even though they were just, you know, folk songs. They weren't really folk songs. They were jazz songs, but I was doing them in a folk mode. Yeah. So anyhow, so I did six-finger style pieces because I tend to write a lot of that stuff. The ideas just kind of come, and then, you know, I flesh them out. So I thought I would play one of those now. Are we getting close to the end of things?
Yes, we're going to do one more at the very end, but let's
have... You and me, yeah.
Yes,
yeah, but this is me. Okay, so this one is a song that I didn't overtly dedicate it to Ed Bickert, but I'm definitely thinking about, you know, the late, great Ed Bickert. He was the most understated and tasteful jazz guitarist ever, and a very humble man, but a true artist, a real giant in that respect. And I had the great fortune of playing with him on a few occasions, and I got him on the cover of Guitar Player magazine because I wrote for Guitar Player for a lot of years.
Yeah.
So. It was one year where I cooked up this thing and they did flexi discs and I got Leona Boyd and Alex Lifeson and I got Ed. And so the four of us were on the cover for this thing called Beyond Borders. Yeah. And that was a real, you know, highlight of my life, that kind of thing, and being able to hang with Ed. And I got lots of Bickert stories, but they'll all have to wait. So I'm going to play this. This is called Cobalt Blue. You know, I cannot match his... his artistry, but hopefully emotionally I can get kind of close to it. So I had a line of poetry in my notebook that said, climb the path or climb the mountain or walk the path through shades of cobalt blue. And so Cobalt Blue became the title for the thing. Okay. Let's see if I can find this will do. Thank you.
Rick. too good. Oh man, almost started bawling there. Yeah, Cobalt Blue, and that's on the Folk Songs for the Farewell Bonfire. Now, can folks, we can get that online, can we?
You can, yeah. Go to rickemmett.com and you can download that. Yep. I don't think you can get it anywhere else.
Just
so
online.
You gotta go to rickemmett.com. Yeah, you have to come to my store.
Come to Rick's store. Yeah. And any other upcoming projects we should know about, Rick?
Oh, man. There's so many things. I got a poetry book that's going to come out on ECW Press. That'll be next year sometime. We got the Triumph has got a documentary that Banger Films did that'll be out on Crave soon, I think. And that'll be a big to-do. There'll be a lot of hoo-ha about that.
Great.
Roundhill is putting out in the States a box set, like a deluxe crazy box set of Triumph stuff. And I've got another couple of things cooking about the first three albums that I did after I left Triumph. I'd never made a deal for those. It looks like I might be cooking something up there, so they may, you know, who knows? I mean, part of it is in COVID, everybody else is sitting around going, well, what can we do, you know?
Yeah.
Like even the guys at Universal Music Canada are going, yeah, what are we going to do? We got to do something. Hey, let's put out some Emmett stuff, you know, so, yeah.
Well, I'm glad you're still working on stuff because, you know, we had Red Green on the show and he imparted some good advice. He said, you don't retire from something. You got to retire to something. You got to keep moving on. So.
Yeah, I mean, I retired from the road, but I did not retire from being creative.
Yeah,
that's
I can see that.
You know, like, in fact, it's almost been like, supercharged.
Yeah. Yeah. Nice. Well, that's just about our show. We're going to finish off with another song, but I do want to thank our sponsors. We have some new sponsors tonight. I'm so grateful because... it does cost a fair bit to, you know, pull this all off. So we've got, first of all, we've got My Dentist is sponsoring the show. Neo Dental, Dr. Steve, we call him.
All right.
He's the greatest dentist in Canada, I'm sure. He comes in wearing sandals and shorts and long hair, and you don't expect him to be your dentist, but he's very, very good at dentistry.
Okay.
We've also got Able Pest Control.
Oh,
one of my old clients from my old marketing company. And Mike Heimbach there jumped right on board when I asked him. We've got Judy Marcel's Real Estate. Judy is here in the audience somewhere. Yeah.
The single person halfway up the house.
It's a single person up there. And we've also got our original sponsor, Marie Phillips, a wonderful woman who's great at money, managing money with her company Next Steps Planning and IPC Securities. And then our regular staff and crew, we got Nathan Fleet on the camera, Dave, he's waving, Dave Plant on sound, Mark Scola getting us out online, and Patrick Maillet with Clear Cable, and our own staff here, Neil Miller and Dan Fournier. And that's about it. Next week, we've got Karen Thornton, a fantastic jazz pianist right here in Hamilton playing for you. Then we've got, I think we're taking Thanksgiving Monday off so we can all eat dinner. And then the following week, we've got Chris Chambers, Dan Edmonds, who used to be with Harlan Pepper, great little band here from the Hammer. We've got the Celtic band Scantily Plaid. And lastly, November 2nd, we got The Hawk with Gary Lucas, Ronnie Hawkins and Gary Lucas. So it's going to be a great month. So come on back next Monday. Oh, I got to leave that up, don't I? Rick taught me an important thing about my guitar. I never noticed. It's got this switch here. And apparently this switch is what makes it sound like jazz. So, and since we're about to do kind of a jazz song, I'm going to leave it on the jazz setting.
Attaboy.
All right. So thanks so much for coming, Rick.
It's been my pleasure.
Really appreciate it. It came all the way from Burlington.
It's been unusual.
Yeah. It's weird, playing with nobody out there.
Well, the Lamps have been a really terrific audience. Thank you.
Oh, yeah.
Thank you for...
Zoe.
So enlightening.
Yeah, it's enlightening here.
To do
it. So what's this last song? Let's have a little story.
Okay, so down memory lane here. There was in 1979, the Just a Game album by Triumph. And, we were short of material. And I'd written a song that when I was out on the road, I had a book of Joe Pass guitar studies. And I'd been working on them, and then I was thinking, if I, just took some of these and then, but I inserted two bars here and changed the chord. And then I could go to a remote key here and I could add a thing. Before I knew it, I was writing a tune. So I played it for the guys in Triumph and they went, "What the hell, Emmett? This is jazz."
Jazz.
And I said, "Yeah, I give them credit. Gil and Mike were always lovely enough to say, "Rick, here's enough rope, go hang yourself." Yeah. So they said, "We'll put it right at the end." The way the Beatles had Her Majesty at the end. Right. It was a mistake, by the way, the way they'd edited the tape. They had no, when they cut that song out of the medley, out of the Abbey Road medley, they'd cut it out. And but EMI never threw tape away. They stuck it on the end of the reel. So then when they sent the master away, to get it mastered, none of the Beatles went to the session. They were hating each other, blah, 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 blah. And so when the mastering guy, ran the master of the thing, he goes, "There's something after the leader, at the end leader." And they went past the end leader, and then this, "Your Majesty's a mini nice girl." And they went, "I guess they want that at the end." So when they mastered the record, they left that at the end. And that's a true story.
Yeah.
We wouldn't make people wait quite as long, but we put Suitcase at the end because it was like an anomaly, something very different. Oh. So that's what we're going to play for you now. And it's just about essentially musicians on the road, scotch. A lot of times you get a rider and you get a bottle of scotch with the rider and somebody gets to take it back to their hotel room, you take turns. So this is what it would be like on a night when it was my turn. So it's called Suitcase Blues. And I have the great pleasure of playing this with the big bad Mike McCurlie.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay, all right. Let me just rubato in at the front.
Yes,
end.
Yes, please. You join away.
But I'm not going to look at your hand because you're playing in a different key than me.
Yeah, I'm playing it.
You'll just throw me right off. So I'm just going to
look away.
To this endless masquerade, halfway through the circuit and headed for the coast. Been gone so long I can't remember what I missed the most. But me and Johnny Walker, the comfort that it brings, waiting on the telephone that never ever rings on the road. lonely road of fortune. And I got the suitcase blues real bad, bad, bad. And here's the bad Mike McCurlie.
Thanks so much, Rick.
Thank you.
And thanks for watching, folks. We'll see you next week. Thanks a lot.